So the second bit of the sequence that we're going to talk about is, of course, the now immortalized Lacrimosa. So this movement's been, it's absolutely captured our imaginations for centuries now, and it's so haunting, and it's an incredible setting of the text. And in some ways it's romantic, forward-thinking, but it's also very Mozartian, or at least the first eight bars are. So give us your rundown on the Lacrimosa before we take a listen.
Sure. The Lacrimosa is, in the larger picture, this is the point at which Mozart's hand and his handwriting and his ideas really leave us in sort of in medias res. So Mozart wrote the first eight bars of this piece. We get through that great crescendo up to beat four of measure eight. And then that's all we have. That's all we have of Mozart. And then we have blank pages where he left space for the rest of the piece. Mm-hmm. There are questions as to whether or not he intended for there to be an amen fugue at the end of this. There are sketches of that. Yet he didn't leave nearly enough room in the folio, in the manuscript paper, to be able to do any sort of drawn out fugue in the same way that he did at the end of the introit. And so, was that to be a part of it? We don't know. What we do know is that we started the sequence with something that was almost wholly written by Mozart, and then we end with the Lacrimosa, which was only written, only eight bars, and the violin introduction, the string introduction. These are the only things that we have.
Yeah.
And so we see, as musicians and as an audience, we see the life force draining out of Mozart, but being transferred to another person. And he is, in essence, trusting someone. He is putting his confidence that another person will be able to follow the directions that he has put on this paper and complete it to the way that he wanted it to be completed. And I think that as someone who was young, if he had lived to be Haydn's age, God only knows what we would have from him and the type of music. Yet he's a light that has been snuffed out early. And as such, we get to see that in physical form in the score. And I think that we also sort of hear it in the music.
I think so.
Because at measure nine, we start to repeat text, and then we get into a very interesting harmonic place when we get when the entire ensemble enters again two bars later. This is from the character that Mozart writes for the people who will eventually complete it. This is like the opening. This is a funeral procession. This funeral procession being in triple time rather than in duple time. It makes it seem slower. It makes time last longer. Mm-hmm. It has the ability of making it feel less like a march and more like swaying or slow plodding, whether at the beginning we really get the idea of a funeral march.
Right.
It's a piece that has been played over and over again in movies, whether it be a movie about Mozart or not. It is clearly something that even to the 21st century ear continues to invoke lamentation and sadness. And I think that Zusmeier did a very, very good job at following that idea and that character all the way to the end. Because we get a very, very decisive ending at the end mm-hmm. of the Lacrimosa. And there would have been probably a good bit of time that would have transpired between the end of the Dies Irae and the beginning of the Offertory. And so there perhaps would have been other chants. There might have been readings. There was a tract that needed to be sung. There were all sorts of pieces that were liturgically prescribed, that Mozart does not set all of them. He chooses to set most of the things that Michael Haydn set before him.
Sure.
In a lot of ways, this could be seen as either an ellipses at the end of Mozart speaking or perhaps a semicolon. We get a little bit more of his music in the offertory. But this is sort of the wrapping up of Mozart's actual craft, of what he did. What comes after is his influence over his studio and the people who worked closely with them. To put out any one of these pieces, a single composer would not be able to do this on the turnaround time that was required for commissions in these days. And so he's writing fast. He's handing this. He would ostensibly, once he finished the score, would have handed it to a copyist who then would have come back and asked about, is this note right? Is this the way you want it? There would have been discussions amidst the studio, and those discussions never got to be had. And so we as musicians are given an enormous amount of freedom in how we interpret this. And I think that's probably the big picture that all of this music brings up, is what is quote unquote authentic, or what is quote unquote what Mozart intended. And that's a big question, and a question that cannot be answered definitively, but a question that each of us in our performance of it are trying to give what we think might be a possible answer to that question, though none of us can answer that definitively.
Wow, very insightful. Thank you. So let's give the Lacrimosa a listen now. Incredible. I think often when I interact with this piece, that this is kind of a, in summation, it's a young man's view of dying. I mean, if you look at Durufle, it's very calm and contemplative, and Brahms has a little bit of a nuanced and philosophical approach, and Verdi's is grand and dramatic and passionate, and it's sort of an operatic take on the Requiem Mass. But Mozart's excerpts, they have a really intense, almost visceral and ferocious outlook on death and dying. And I think it's highlighted even more by Zussmeier's very stark skeletal treatment of the orchestration and the completion. It's almost, in a way, it reminds me of the St. John Passion, how it looks at Christ's suffering and death. It's very startling. It's very in your face, as much as music of Mozart's time and style can be. I mean, in lots of ways, it feels like the C minor Mass and the Requiem are sort of the most daring and forward-looking bits of music that Mozart wrote, and he didn't even get to complete them. It's such a shame. I can only imagine what these would have looked like if we were able to see a completion in Mozart's hand. So what are your concluding thoughts on the Mozart Requiem?
Well, I think the question that you asked is a good one. It's like, what would this have looked like in Mozart's hand? And many, many, many composers have tried to see what that would be. And I think that when, you know, if metaphorically we die and go to where all old composers go to and get to meet the master himself, and we ask him, what were you actually intending? We're going to find out that this would have been a much, much, much different piece had he completed it. But I think that part of it being incomplete and being a work of many people's hands and many people's promotion, I think that's sort of why it's become such a special piece in the repertoire, because each of us as a musician is no longer constrained by how was the first performance when the composer conducted this. Well, the first performance when the composer conducted this was 12 to 18 hours before he died, listening to his friends sing the last piece of music that he wrote. It was a piece of comfort probably for him. It was a piece that he interacted with his closest associates, his closest musical and familial associates. And I think that we, as musicians, can take this as a model. I think that every time Seraphic Fire approaches this work, we approach it as a company of people who have been given a question by one of the greatest musical minds of our time. And it's up to us to figure out how is this question answered, both in a performance and in the choices that we make. How many instruments do we use? You know, Mozart, when I have performed it, I've had two different sizes of orchestras. I've had a tiny church balcony-esque orchestra, and I've had 18 first violins in another orchestra with a chorus of 350. And the interesting thing about this music is that it survives every treatment that you put on it, whether it be, there's some really remarkable recordings from the 60s where I think the introit is taken at perhaps half the speed that would be considered normal these days. And even at that speed, it is incredibly, incredibly effective. And I think that shows that Mozart was writing music in this sense for practical use and a music that could live beyond him. Whether or not when he began it, he knew that it was going to be his last piece, he certainly knew this by the end of his, by the end of his composing it. And so instead of writing in the detailed way that he does in the introit, where every small, beautiful, meticulous detail is laid out, he lays out the very basic things that he needs to communicate in order for this to have his name on it.
Right.
And so he lays out the structure. He gives us the emotional character of the chorus, of each of the movements, of the soloists. And he gives a remarkable amount of musical material that if he was planning on using the Agnus Dei and the communion to be a conclusion, we can see how Zussmeier's completion is very, it certainly is appropriate for the time period. If we're looking for something that is a concert work that is appropriate to the time period, I love the Zussmeier. I think it has remarkable music, even when it's music that's not being written by Mozart, particularly the Benedictus of the of the sonata. But it also allows us the chance to engage composers and scholars of our own day to say, either write something that is absolutely like in pretend you're Zismayer and create something, or this is the question that Mozart poses, write an answer.
What's your answer? Right.
Don't be Mozart, be yourself. What's your answer to this?
Have at it.
I think that there has to, any performer who approaches this piece has to have their own personal answer to that question. None of these answers will be fact. They will be answers of opinion, but having that opinion about what this means in the course of music history, what this meant to Mozart as a composer when he first got it and when he ended up with it. You know, people say, you know, what was the composer's intent? Well, when the composer originally got this, his intent was to make money. And that was certainly the intent of his family afterward. But as he began to deal with more and more profound things in his life, I think that he moved beyond simply the idea of a commission and wrote a memorial piece, not even for himself, but for the music of his time and the music that had preceded him.
That's an amazing insight. So if you have time now, go and find a recording of the whole thing and watch it with all of these thoughts in mind. Patrick, thank you so much for spending your afternoon talking about Mozart with me. I can't think of many ways that I would like to spend this afternoon other than that. So thanks for joining us. Thank you for your wisdom and insight. And as always, keep us updated with what Seraphic Fire is doing, and we will make sure that our audience and our listeners get to partake in that. And thank you once again. Everyone, please don't miss next week. We have part one of a double series of conversations with Tom Koopman about the Matthew Passion by Bach. So you definitely don't want to miss that. Patrick, thank you again.
Pleasure. Really great to be here. Thanks for inviting me, Blake.
Of course. Well, everyone, stay safe and keep the music going, and we will see you soon.